Hello, hello. First of all, I think on behalf of both Lonny and Liz, I just want to say after you've seen this, you can appreciate why the Actors Fund is so vital to the community and the larger community. I'm sure the Actors Fund helped a lot of these folks through the difficult times that followed the opening of Merrily. But it is with unbelievable thrill and excitement that I'm going to introduce the two guests tonight. First, Liz, are you back there? There you are. Okay. Liz Callaway. Liz made her Broadway debut in Merrily, of course. And she's also a Tony nominee and an Emmy winner. And she's an actress and a recording artist and an amazing, amazing singer. And you've been part of the Broadway community since Merrily. And I'm just going to give a few highlights.
Oh, I should have waited to come up.
You were nominated for a Tony for Baby, the Maltby Shire production, which was incredible. Spitfire Grill and Miss Saigon, and you were an amazing Grisabella in Cats. I love that production so much. You've also maintained, like Lonny has, an amazing connection with Sondheim since Merrily, and have performed in so many of amazing events, classic events that have honored his work.
You know, actually one of the highlights, probably one of the biggest highlights and what we could talk about when Lonny gets here was that reunion concert was just one of the great moments. And another highlight of my career was getting to do Follies in Concert back in 1985, and I did that with Jim Walton. So it was great remembering that.
Also worth noting is that your amazing singing voice has been heard on so many in animated films.
Yeah.
I'm sure, saw Anastasia, and this is Anastasia. And Odette in The Swan Princess, and you were Jasmine in the Aladdin sequels. And in Lion King 2, it was the grown-up little lion cub.
PR. This is so embarrassing.
So,
but go on.
But
really.
It's important, given that Merrily, you're getting to know everybody. It's really important that, you know, life after Merrily, and because we're going to talk about, you know, some of the things that you must have gone through after that experience. But it certainly hasn't stopped you, and it didn't hold you back. So important to acknowledge all those things. And next, director extraordinaire, also actor extraordinaire, Lonny Price. I'm going to leave out a ton because we'd be here all night. So I'm just going to give some highlights, but I want to start by saying that Lonny is one of a kind in the Broadway community, because when you think about all the beloved artists and creators in our community that just go right to Lonny when they have a very important project, you are the go-to collaborator for the greatest artists of our day, whether it's Sondheim or Audra McDonald or Glenn Close currently in Sunset Boulevard, Patti LuPone. They all want Lonny to collaborate with to create their art. And I just don't think it gets better than that. That makes such a huge statement about who you are.
So sweet.
But you saw a little bit of Lonny's background, you know, as a film actor in Dirty Dancing and one of my favorites, The Muppets Take Manhattan. And I really was changed by seeing you in Master Harold and the Boys. I just thought that was landmark production. I hope you all saw that a while back. In addition to the Broadway shows that you've done, you've also directed these landmark concerts with the New York Philharmonic. Did you see Sweeney Todd with Patti LuPone and George Hearn? That was unbelievable. And Kristen Chenoweth and Candide. And of course, if anyone here got a ticket to the Sondheim birthday concert at Carnegie Hall, you are very cool. And Company with Neil Patrick Harris and Stephen Colbert. I mean, I'm going to stop because we'll be here all night. So, and now a brilliant filmmaker. So, it's.
So I'm sweating so much. Thank you.
But I wanted to give you guys a background because I think one of the first questions that I certainly thought about after watching this film again is. I wrote it down exactly as I was watching it again. Many pages of notes.
She's got a lot of questions.
Well, it just the trauma of that experience for both of you. Does taking risk in your life, did that hold you back going forward? It obviously didn't with all what you both have accomplished, but I would imagine seeing that all unfold before your eyes was traumatic in a way, and did it change who you are today in terms of your risk taking as artists?
I don't know if it changed me. I truly believe that I think now it was like the ideal first Broadway show experience. It really was, because we were working with the best people. And by the way, Company was the first Broadway show I saw, and I was obsessed with the cast album too. Just like we all had the same story. But we were working with the best people in the business on something that was a failure. And so that I went, oh, that's what this business is. That's what it's going to be. And I remember during the waiting period, is when we had all our parties and everything, I actually worked quite a bit. I did a TV movie with Jim Weisenbach and Jason Alexander called Senior Trip with Mickey Rooney. And so I kind of got to know them before the show. And I remember the first week of rehearsals, Jason and I had dinner, and we went, this has problems. I don't know. But by the time we opened, we thought we fixed them. And then I remember getting the New York Times and seeing that, reading Frank Rich's review and going, oh, that's right, we're gonna close, and that's it. But I was devastated. I went back to being a waitress right away, but I was okay still. I mean, the title of your documentary is perfect, because it was like the worst, best thing, the best, worst thing that you could possibly experience. So, but I don't think it didn't keep me from doing anything. I think, who was it in the documentary who said that it actually, was it Annie who said that it was okay? You could fail, yes. and then you know, succeed after that. So I was devastated, but I wasn't down. That was a long answer. Sorry.
We were very protected, you know. I mean, it was a failure very quickly. It's a quick failure, you know. The first preview was bad, but they always made us feel like we were great, and I just always assumed they'd fix it because they were who they were, and are. But no, I don't think it frightened me at all. It never occurred to me that was. I was so proud of it, I just thought, oh, maybe it's ahead of its time, or the score was so undeniably great. And when the album came out, and that obviously made everybody appreciate a lot more of it than they did from watching it. So the truth is, no, it did not in any way make me afraid to try. So it didn't work like that for me.
I would imagine that the experience that you had with Hal Prince and Stephen Sondheim was a little different than if they were working with adult actors. How was it different, do you think, now that you have a different perspective?
Well, I mean, one thing, I direct now, and I don't think I would ever put actors through what they put us through. And I think that's because we were young. We were just, we did everything they told us. I mean, one night was, we had a turntable, and the song Opening Doors, and I'm pushing a piano with Jimmy, and Annie's pushing a table with a typewriter and a lot of cigarettes on it, and we were putting through a lot of changes, and Hal said, oh, we don't have time. Turntable's going to go a little faster tonight. Don't worry about it. It's going to be fine. And you would never do that to people. And older, I mean, people 25 would say, could we rehearse that turntable thing? So we do the song, and it starts to whip around, and the piano starts to go into the pit. And and it was a mess. It was horrible. But I just think no one would allow me to do that. But because we went, okay, Hal, you know, we'll just, you know, whatever. Yeah, great. And we learned massive amounts of material a day.
Oh, yeah. I was actually in the chorus, and I understudied Annie Morrison. And so who played Mary. So a lot of my perspective was just observing. And during rehearsals, we previewed for 2 months, and Annie got sick, so I used to sit in the front row of the Alvin Theater, and I would sing her songs for her while she would do the new book scenes. And, you know, so I remember, and Annie said, for a very short run, do you want to go on? I'm like, no, there was no way. I couldn't have done it. It was perfect for me to be in the chorus and to get to do understudy rehearsal, but then when we did the reunion concert, I did Beth, which was great. Although I remember I said, I still want to do my solo lines in the chorus.
And you did.
I did, because it was so important to me. But I was amazed at how you guys did, because I thought Hal was, I was very intimidated by everyone, but I thought, Hal, you guys were in some ways on your own, having to, you know, there was so much going on, and I thought you were tremendous. I thought the cast was tremendous, and I enjoyed watching the process, and was relieved to not really be a part of it in that way.
Well, you don't know, you know, at that age, you just do what they tell you, and your mind is, your memory's good at that point. Not anymore. Not anymore. You are, no. So that's, we just did everything they told us to do, and it didn't occur to us that it was more, I think, than they would have given adults to do. But it was huge amounts of changes very quickly. And one time, I remember the song Old Friends, they decided had to stop the show. It was just had to stop the show. And they worked on a 5-minute dance routine in the middle of it. They wanted it to be, you guys know the movie Singing in the Rain? They wanted it to be Good Morning. You know, they go over the couch and it falls, you know, they wanted it to be that. And it never was that. But anyway, we worked on a dance routine for it, I don't know, for like 5 days. But we'd play the old version at night. And then we'd rehearse the new version during the day. And there came a point where we didn't know which version we were doing. And we just stopped and looked at each other and started to laugh. Because it just was like, is the new one in tonight, or does it go in tomorrow night? Or there was so much going on that we just couldn't keep up with it at times. But it was kind of fun. You know, it wasn't scary, because they treated us like we were their children. They were Uncle Hal and Uncle Steve, yeah. And they were so loving to us, and all of the pressure that they must have been under, they never shared with us. It was always, you guys are great. And here's a new book, you know, here's a new 40 pages, put that in tonight.
That was part of the excitement, though. It was. I think we didn't know any better, because we were so young. But talking about new material, I remember there was, we'd had these transitions, little musical transitions. There'd be like 5 of us who would come out and sing a little blurb, and it would basically tell the audience what year it was. And they decided to fix one of the transitions that day, and they gave us a new piece of music, and there were 5 of us, and we spent our dinner break practicing, and you know, the new choreography, the new lyrics and everything, and it was brand new music. And I remember then we ran from stage left on stage to start it. We started singing it, but they hadn't given the orchestra the new music. So we're sort of trying to sing it, and then Paul Gemignani cuts out the orchestra, and then I don't know, it was Eddie Strauss, whoever was playing the piano, finished it. And then we ran off stage the way we came on as we were choreographed. I remember we fell on the floor laughing, and then we cried because we were so, you know, humiliated. But it was awesome. It really was. It was great. You don't remember the things that go well. You have these incredible memories. That's why I can't tell you how grateful I am that you made this, because it just, you know, there were moments of it. The second time I've seen it now, and the first time, there were stories and things that had happened. I remember saying to my husband, this is what happened back then, but I wasn't sure if I remembered correctly, like Steve singing at your birthday party. And that, I was like, it did happen. And then tonight my son is here, who I so wanted to see this in a theater, because I've been talking to him about it. So it's, you just did such a beautiful job. So I'm,
absolutely.
I really, it's like the show lives on now. It's really nice.
One of my favorite things in the film is when Frank Rich admits he's been listening to the album over and over again. I wonder if he was going to write that review today, if it would be very different.
I wanted to ask him that. I actually wanted him to read the original review, and he wouldn't do it.
But you know, it's so interesting, but he does now all these, you know, Q&As with Steve all around the country. So they, like, you know, they do these things together, so they definitely made up.
I would imagine with Uncle Hal and Uncle Steve that it was traumatic for them to disappoint you. Did you have any sense of that from them?
Well, closing night, Hal came into my dressing room, and he said, I'm sorry, I wanted to give you a hit. He said, I think I gave you a good show, but I didn't give you a hit, and I really wanted to, and I'm sorry. And it broke my heart, because I wanted to be good for him. You know, I just wanted him to be proud of what I did, and that he was taking such responsibility for it. It was very, very moving to me, and that he cared to say that. But even Steve at the New York Film Festival, you know, said, and actually cried that night, which I'd hardly ever seen him do, and just said he had flops before, but not with kids, where he felt he had, I think he said he pushed us out of the nest too early, and we fought and we fell, and he felt responsible for hurting us. But I think the truth is that we all are fine, and nobody really got hurt, and we all wouldn't have traded that experience for anything. So I think, because of the film, feels, he's told me he feels like he's healed from that feeling that he disappointed the kids, and they would all end up in a gutter somewhere, I don't know.
I want to think that the moment at your birthday party where you pressed the button and started to record Sondheim singing to you was the moment you decided to make this documentary. Is that true?
When did you decide to do it?
Well, when we did the reunion concert, and I was singing old friends to Jimmy Walton, and I realized he was my old friend, and that I really wasn't singing my characters, I was singing my own life, and that line started to blur, that we were those people who were friends for 25 years. And wouldn't that be interesting to see how the characters had reflected in our lives and we in their life? And that, that was the moment of singing old friends to Jimmy that made me think, it's Pirandello. I'm no longer Charlie and Frank, it's Lonnie and Jim. And that was a very odd and wonderful feeling, so.
Such a beautiful thing that you've paralleled the show in your documentary. As we were talking about a moment ago, you could have done plain old making of, or, you know, behind the scenes, but you really tried to do something so beautiful here, and bring, I think, Merrily full circle.
Well, I also, Bruce Klein is here, my producer, Bruce David Klein, sitting right there with his wife, Hillary. And Bruce believed in it beyond anything, and for 5 years we kept showing him one terrible cut after another, and he kept saying, no, there's something in there, we're going to keep going. And through his guidance and five editors and 9 years of work from my part, and then I think five from Bruce's, it was a lot of chipping away. So, but I was grateful and lucky to have someone who believed that it could be more than the making of and supported us. So you need to meet him, Dori. That's what I'm saying.
You worked on it for 2 years before that footage was uncovered.
Yeah.
So you know, you watched the film and you just can't believe what was captured. But I love that you were committed to this idea even before that footage was uncovered. And then could you talk for a minute about that you hired somebody?
Yeah, I mean, Bruce, we found this guy's name is John Miller Monzon. There are people who seek out footage, you know, that has been destroyed or that people think have been destroyed or is lost. And when we met him, this was my favorite, is he said, I explained the whole thing, and he said, well, I think you have a 9% chance of finding this. Not, it was like, not even 10? 9? I mean, but I just knew it was there. I just thought, I just don't believe they destroyed it, because everyone said they destroyed it. And I just said, it's there, it's somewhere. And is it Pennsylvania that it was found, like in a mountain in Pennsylvania where they, no, seriously, because it was celluloid, so it doesn't disintegrate, and it was like underground. And that I thought, when I opened the boxes, I thought, oh, this has been waiting for me. This has been waiting for me to have it, and I felt very like woo about it, like that. Yeah.
Well, but the behind-the-scenes footage of Broadway is so rare; it's just so hard because of union rules and regulations to get that kind of footage in the can. It is just a treasure, and such history, Broadway history, and how you incorporated it is masterful. Really, what was aside from this, you know, how long it took? What were some of the challenges of telling this story? And I know one of the things I'd love for you to talk about is I read somewhere that you originally were not planning on having yourself in the film. That surprised me.
Well, I mean, that's part of the challenge. Was there were two. One was we had a lot of cuts where we do the making of the show, and then what happened to us felt like a different movie. Mm. And it never quite flowed. Bruce and I were talking about it tonight at dinner. It always felt like a different film. And figuring out how to make our journeys after the making of feel inevitable to the story that you wanted to see what happened to us, instead of, oh, I'm not that interested in those people. Where's Hal and Steve? You know, where are the more fancy people? Mm-hmm. So that took a really long time. And what you brought up is, what do we do with me? I initially didn't want to be in it at all. And then Bruce kept saying, no, it's a personal, you are part of it. And so we had interviews with me, which we cut. Did I narrate it? Am I in it? Do you see me? When do you see me? How much is too much? What makes it look like a vanity movie? So those both what happened to us and me were the trickiest parts of negotiating the correct amounts of it. And that took a long time.
Mm-hmm. The response you know, from the community to this film is so beautiful, particularly given where it started out. I mean, it's been completely embraced, and the show is also embraced. Could you talk for a minute just to give perspective, because it is performed everywhere now and it's such a treasured show. Did they continue to work on it after the original?
Yes, I think it was the first production, was it La Jolla?
Yeah.
I think they did it in La Jolla, and James Lapine directed it. And then they did in Washington, and there's been lots of different versions of it. I think that was, except for when it's been done in schools, I think that was the last time it was done with young people.
Yeah.
And I actually had never seen a production of it. I saw it at Encores mm-hmm. did it a couple years ago, and of course we've had like these little get-togethers where we've all stayed friends and stayed in touch, and we went to see it. And there were changes in it. I was like, what happened? And I'm you know, so partial to as much as what I can remember what we ended up with. But, you know, I don't know. I know that there have mm-hmm. been lots of different versions, and then Maria Friedman's, the London version, I think, was very well received, and I have not seen that either.
And I just want to point out, with all the changes that happened after the original Merrily, Frank Rich is listening to the original cast album. Just wanted to point that out.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's take your questions.
Hi, good evening. So in the film, you mentioned the power of the critics, and Clive Barnes had a positive review. So how has that impacted your career in the making of this movie, the role of critics in theater and in movies?
Well, my personal thing about critics is that I don't actually read any of them. I and that's, you know, a lot of people say that, but I actually haven't read a review of mine for more than 30 years. The last one I read said, it was an acting review, and it said I was the love child of Dustin Hoffman and Marty Feldman. and I thought, oh, that's, I don't even, ew, and I just, so I mean, that thought was really frightening to me, and I thought, I don't know that these are helping me anymore. But that was a really long time ago, so I'm actually both terrified of them, and I stay away from them, because I find the, you know, it's an old thing, the good ones are never good enough, and the bad ones are devastating, and what you remember is the bad ones. You remember all the bad
you
ones.
You only remember the bad ones. John Simon used to be the big critic for New York Magazine, and I can quote you, I can just quote them all. And actually, it was like a badge of honor. If he didn't like you, that was considered a really good thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And then years later, he reviewed, I don't know if it was Spitfire Grill or something, and he said the always wonderful Liz Callaway, which I thought was so funny, but then I was actually disappointed. Aww. I was like kind of used to, like, what's he going to say now? Although I tend not to, I'm like you, I tend not to. Back then, the New York Times had, in particular,
was everything.
It really was about getting a good New York Times review.
Well, particularly with no star, you know, and we were a pretty easy target for them. And don't forget, after Sweeney Todd and, you know, Company, Follies, A Little Night Music, you know, Pacific Overture, I mean, they had one hit after another. And even if they weren't successful financially, they were hugely respected artistically. So, and Sweeney Todd being the last, but right before us, which was, you know, probably their masterpiece. And then in we came, limping along, and I think we were an easy target for people to finally go, oh, they've had enough. They've really had enough. And they didn't hold back on their disappointment in that the show wasn't better.
Up here, is this on? Yeah, it was a really enjoyable film. So I'm just gonna keep going on the critic thing. So did Hal come to you all the next night after opening night? Obviously you'd read the reviews. Did he come backstage and give you any kind of speech or pep talk and say, forget about it, whatever?
Yeah, I mean, I think that after, don't worry about it, we're gonna run. Yeah. You know, they always do that. That's sort of like, you know, we're gonna make a run for it.
And then they put the notice up, you know, but yeah.
Like the thing that I know is that, because his daughter was in it, and she would come home at night and say half the house was gone in the second act, and he basically said to me pretty recently, he knew that we'd be playing to smaller and smaller audiences, even as they were trying to save it, and he did not want to do that to the kids. He just didn't want to put us through that. I think if he had asked us, we would have said, we don't care, we'll play it for three people, you know. But I think it was hard for him with his daughter being in it, and he felt embarrassed, I think, in front of her, that he did not give her a show that was good, that was a hit. And I think he just thought he would save us all. And there was talk we were going to move off Broadway for a while, that they'd scale it down. And then we're going to film it for a minute from RKO. Niederlander was going to film it. It all just sort of fizzled, and it all just went away. And we almost didn't do the album because in those days you had to run three weeks, 24 performances before the record company, in that case RCA, with their contract would kick in where they would record it, and they didn't want to do it. And Hal went to them and said, you'll never get another one of Steve's and mine if you don't do this. And the album, if you ever see the cover of it, is a big picture of Steve. It's not even like a show album. and the Hirschfeld kind of around it. It's like Steve looks like he's dead. It's like a memorial. Very serious picture of Steve, sort of profiling. And then the back had the logo of it because they were in, they thought no one's going to buy this album. And had the album not been recorded, nothing would have. I think the show would have had a very different trajectory. But just the music was so undeniable that I think it made people want to do it so much more. I mean, Steve's shows would always get done, but I think that album really galvanized it, and they didn't want to do it. They really wanted out.
I find, too, I do a lot of concerts around the country, and I almost always talk about Merrily and do something from the show, and I do my two chorus solo lines. And but I'll talk about how, you know, we ran for 2 weeks, and there's always someone, oh, I was there, and now it's a badge of honor if you saw it. And it's kind of extraordinary to be in something that at the time was, you know, was despised by some people in a I think overly emotional reaction to it. But now it's like this incredible, I'm so proud to have been in the original cast, even with just what little I did in it. It was, and now people think it's one of, you know, the best Sondheim shows. And it's just, it's really, it's a tremendous history to have with a show. And I have a memory of right after we closed, Hal tried to get jobs for people. They asked me to come in. I think, come in and audition for the standby for Mrs. Lovett. I was like, what? You know, or something. But they were trying, you know, to get us work. And so it was sweet. It was very sweet.
Was the intended first prospect of making the documentary with all the original archival footage almost, in a sense, a second installment of a Sondheim documentary, like there was the making of the company cast recording documentary?
Can you repeat the question one more time for me, please?
Was all the archival footage that was intended to be made into a documentary in the first place, was that meant to almost be a second installment
of the company?
Yes, as in a Sondheim documentary.
No, ABC, there was a show, a local show, I don't know if anybody's older, well, people remember Close Up? It was an ABC show that was sort of like a magazine show. And they were doing the making of a musical. And it was ABC. I don't think it had anything to do with the great company documentary at all. But the other thing is, you know, in terms of how hard it is to get cameras in, they didn't realize that they would have to pay all the actors SAG minimum. And so that was one of the reasons they pulled it, was they couldn't afford it. They couldn't actually afford to pay everybody. But the real reason it was pulled was, I mean, the central reason is that ABC Corporation had an investment in the show. And they found out and thought it was a conflict of interest. Now it would be synergy. Then it was a conflict of interest. We had morals back then. And so they didn't want to promote on a news show. They didn't want to promote a show that they actually had an investment in. And that was why they said they pulled it. And then they found out about having to pay the actors. And I think that's why they said they destroyed it, because they didn't want any record that actors were there without being paid.
Wait, should I be paid for that? I'm just asking.
But not from this documentary. No. You shouldn't be paid.
I'll go to ABC.
Hi. Did Stephen Sondheim and Hal Prince ever acknowledge that the demise of Merrily destroyed their partnership? And did they ever try, besides this reunion concert, to come back together and work together again?
Well, I think Steve says, you know, that he felt that the animosity towards them, that I think he puts it really beautifully, that they were mavericks who were successful. You know, it's okay, what does he say? I think it's okay to be daring and be unsuccessful, that's okay. But it's not okay to be daring and be successful financially. And he said that he felt that people didn't forgive them for that. And so he said, I have to get out of this. They very briefly collaborated on a show called, it was called Bounce when they did it. It was Wise Guys, then wound up as Gold, Bounce, Roadshow. And for a brief time, Hal was directing it in at the Goodman. And I guess that didn't go terrifically well. And so actually Merrily was the last of it. So in terms of them acknowledging that, I don't think they've ever put it into those words, but clearly this was the, as it's turned out, they've never, Hal says sometimes, like, I thought we'd take a break. He didn't realize it would be this long and that it would not happen again.
Thank you so much for your extraordinary documentary. I've always kind of been a show doctor, and this is one that has thrown me. I have never been able to figure
where
out.
Where are you? Could you raise your hand for
here?
Me? Ah, there you are. Okay.
With all of the years that have gone by and all of the different variations of this show and all that people have learned in the doing, do you think it would be possible with this information to go back to your original show and make it a hit?
My personal feeling is that Hal's idea that it was kids was the right approach to this material, because I think the meta idea is if you get to the end of the show and they actually were 18, and you would think if you could get that connection that these performers themselves would not make the mistakes of the characters they were playing, is rather a thrilling idea. I don't know that it's possible to communicate that. And so if I would ever direct it, which I don't think I ever will, I'd want it to be the kids again. But they don't want that version. Stephen Sondheim is very clear that he does not like that version and that it won't ever be performed again, which has certain songs like The Hills of Tomorrow that have been removed, and that whole frame of kids is gone. And I still personally think it was the right way to do the material. But Mr. Sondheim doesn't agree. So I'm not sure it'll ever.
I agree with you, too. I also think there's something about the show in some ways that it's a perfect show to do as a concert. Because when we did not do book scenes. We did not do any of the book scenes in the reunion concert. And it was still thrilling, and it still told the story without, you know, getting bogged down in specifics and of the book, and I think it could live on like that. Well, obviously, people are still always going to be doing it, but I would love. I agree with you. I love the original. I love what we had, and the idea of it. I thought it was, to quote both Steve and Hal, I thought it was swell.
So we have time for one last question.
When I saw Six by Sondheim, I was really impressed at the loving attention that was given to the opening doors number, which was the only part that Steve put himself in, and he said it was his only autobiographical song. Right. And I was wondering, back when you were in the show, did you understand the personal connection that Steve had to the music, and or was it an evolutionary process for him, sort of colored by time?
Yeah, you know, he's always said that was, you know, him and Mary Rogers and Sheldon Harnick and all of those contemporaries, you know, at the beginning of their careers. I don't think he told us that when we were learning it all those years ago. And maybe in retrospect, he looked back and said, oh, that was the only autobiographical song I've ever written. But I didn't know that or was aware of it at the time. And now it makes perfect sense, you know, when you think about it. But yeah, absolutely.
Well, I'd like to thank the Actors Fund so much for sponsoring tonight.
Yes, yay.
Can I do a quick shout out about the Actors Fund? You know,
yes.
Every Broadway show that's running does an Actors Fund performance, and everyone donates their services. We didn't run long enough to do one with Merrily, but we would have. But I've been involved with the Actors Fund for so many years, and they are the most incredible organization. They help so many different people in the business. I never thought that I've just done things for the Actors Fund. They have helped my family personally in so many ways. And so for all of you who support the Actors Fund and for everyone here at the Actors Fund. It's really an organization that you should all know about, and I think this is such a great series to, this is, I live 20 minutes from here, so this is my favorite place to see a movie, so I'm so delighted that the Actors Fund and Jacob Burns are collaborating on this.
Hear, hear, yay, Actors Fund. Yeah. Great.
And I'd like to thank Lonny and Liz so much for sharing your story and your magnificent film with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you.